topic is scaling from team to organizational agility. So that's the topic we are looking to cover, as Vrishank mentioned, as part of the Agile 2021 Reflect Festival that's being organized by a group of volunteers from across the globe. So it's great pleasure and privilege to be part of the event. Now, if we get into the topic, I would like to know, what does agility mean to you? You can probably type in the chat window. I think we would look at it. What does agility mean to you? Can you share one word, two words on the chat window? Sorry. Can I see the chat here? I'm just trying to. Okay, flexibility. Adapting as per need. Rajesh is okay. Satya Priya, adaptability. Able to experiment and fail fast. Okay. Situational changes, adapting to change on the go. Quick response to changes. Agility means to achieve the desired results. Okay, by probably adapting is what he meant. Okay, so as we understand, what is agility? The ability to change direction quickly, adapting to the dynamically changing environment while maintaining or enhancing the performance levels without increasing the level of risk. So this is what I mean by agility, or agility means to me. It is about the ability to adapt, but ability to adapt without downgrading our performance and enhancing the risks. So a lot of people feel, okay, agility means, okay, you should be able to take up more risks. That essentially should not be the case. You should be able to manage the level of risk again within the organizational level, control levels that we are looking for, and still be able to adapt. And because you are trying to be agile, it doesn't mean that your performance should go down. The expectation from being agile is to either maintain the current performance levels or increase the performance levels to the next threshold that we are looking at. So yes, the ability to change direction quickly means, because the current world that we are living in, which we call as VUCA, is quite dynamic in nature. So the ability to change direction quickly and adapt to the ever-changing environment. By the time you are adapting, probably the environment is again changing. So it's a kind of continuous adaptation that you are looking at. And then, because everything is changing, you still don't want your performance as an individual or as a team or as an organization to go down. The intent is to either maintain or enhance. During the course of transformation, at least you should maintain the performance level what it is today. And then through the transformation journey, you should aim to enhance the performance levels. That is what agility means to me. Especially the level of risk is something which we don't focus on when we talk about agility. But when you are talking about organizational agility, it is very important that we don't push the limits of the risks that we have. Okay, so now if you are looking at team agility, what all aspects that we need to concentrate on if you are talking about team agility? The first thing should be to understand what all aspects you look into when you are talking about agility itself. So when you talk about a team or an organization or a portfolio or a product, so these elements are something which you can't do away with. You have to work through your transformation journey around these six elements. The first one is products, practices, the culture, the processes, the capabilities, and the leadership. These are essential elements or mandated elements for us to focus on whenever you are talking about agility at any level, whether it is at team level or at product level or value stream level or portfolio level or organization level. So these six elements are something which we will focus on at a team level, how you are looking at or what aspects within these elements you focus on. But when you are talking about organizational agility, around these elements itself, how the aspects change, and then what you will need to focus on when you are looking at an organizational agility to be accomplished. Okay, when you talk about products, now at a team level, when you are talking about products, you essentially are looking at and trying to understand the vision that is, defined by the product management community of the organization. Now, I understand probably many of the folks here might be from non-IT background. So if you talk about a community, probably a project to build a 5,000, apartment complex, if that is what we are looking as a project or as an organizational outcome that we are looking for. Understanding as a team that is trying to deliver that outcome, understanding the vision of the organization around that outcome that we are looking to accomplish needs to be pretty clear to each and every individual within the team. And that should come from the product management community that is driving that particular outcome. Okay, now, second, the focus is on delivering product functions or functions that contribute or provide a service to that particular outcome. And that is what is the focus on from a product perspective when you are talking at a team level. And then you, as a team, you also focus on inter and intra-team dependencies, right? So you are looking at what are the dependencies amongst different individuals within the team. And possibly you are also talking about dependencies that are outside the team. So that is another focus. So from a product perspective, these are three elements that you would focus on when you are talking about team level agility. Now moving to the next one, from a practices perspective, when you are talking at a team level, you are talking about any framework-driven events. Now, if you ask me, is it mandatory for having a framework and following the events that are defined by the framework? I would say yes and no, because if you are some team that is starting entirely afresh, and if you don't have the right mindset to be agile, then you will need the framework. What the framework does, it gives you the certain set of practices and events through which you can start developing the right mindset that we look for when you want to be agile. So that is what it brings. So you, as a team, when you are looking at it, you talk about framework-driven events, whether it is if you are following Scrum, basically in IT, if you talk about, but if you talk about non-IT elements, then we mostly focus on either Kanban or another officially coined term now, that is Scrumban. But mostly Kanban, if you are talking of industries that are entirely different to IT. For example, we are working with one of the engineering colleges for them to be agile. Now, that is an entirely non-IT community, right? So when you talk about that, as a team, how you are trying to be agile in an educational environment, so what we are looking at from that point of view is we are starting with one particular team, means in the whole engineering college, we are talking about only the computer engineering, computer science engineering department. That is where we are starting on. So what we are doing there in terms of a framework implementation is about implementing Kanban to manage their workload and how we are trying to help them to be agile. So we spoke to the students to understand what does agility mean when we are trying to be agile, when your team of professors are trying to be agile, what is your expectation from that, what you are looking to get as value from them being agile. So the student community responded saying, okay, now for us to take greater value, essentially that the classes are driven by time. That means you have classes scheduled for 1 hour. Now, irrespective of the professors, whether they are able to logically conclude a particular chapter or a part of the chapter that they are teaching, they essentially may not plan for logical conclusion there. When the bell strikes, they would see where they are and then try to conclude. So what the students meant was, we would get greater value if they are able to put the time according to the amount of coverage they want to have on any particular topic. So we moved away from an hourly delivery model to talk about, okay, in this particular week, this is what as outcome you want to deliver to the students. So how much time you would need? So from 1 hour they moved on. Somebody said, okay, if I were to logically split this chapter into two or three parts, how do I split? What is the logical conclusion? And then I can look to connect that in the next time when I go and cover. So they logically split the chapters into two or three, and that meant that, first time when they are covering part one, they probably spend 1.5 hour, while the second time when they are covering, they are spending probably only 1 hour or even 2 hours. So that depended on how they are able to logically split. Now, why I am saying this as an example is that many times we feel agile is meant for IT industry. No, it's not. At least I don't consider it that way. Agile is for anyone. It's about what agility means to you in that particular context of your industry or the work you are trying to accomplish, right? So outcomes you are looking for. So that's where, again, the framework comes into play. It helps you to understand and work out how you can be agile. So, but if you have the mindset, you may think, a lot of you might be thinking that is logical, that or common sense, that people should be able to logically conclude at the end of 1 hour. But that is your understanding of the logic. Does the students also feel the same way? Probably not. And that's what we found out, right? So this is where the framework driven events or any framework comes into play, and it kind of mandates you to look at what is the value that you are trying to accomplish for your stakeholder or customer, whoever it is. Okay. And the second one is the craftsmanship. Again, from an IT point of view, you talk about craftsmanship, best technical practices or whatever. But when you talk about any other industry, anything that you are doing or, anything you are doing to accomplish that work. If you are in a construction area, then how you can probably do it much faster, whether it is a mason or anybody or an architect who is designing, right? So that is from a craftsmanship practices. And quality outcomes, always the focus should be on providing quality outcomes. The level of quality that you want to achieve will also drive the best practices as well. So the focus should not just be on following framework driven events and best craftsmanship. If you are not able to deliver the outcomes with the right quality that your customer is expecting. Okay, so from practices point of view, at a team level, you focus on these aspects. Now from culture. Essentially, we are born and brought up to compete. Right from our childhood, when we start going to the first probably school or any play school, even there our competition starts. Our parents would look at, or we ourselves, when we become parents also, we are looking to compare our children with others and how fast they are. So the culture of competition is built into our mind. But when you are talking about agile, we are trying to move from culture of competition to culture of collaboration. And that is something which we need to focus on, right? When you are trying to be agile at a team level, how collaborative each and every individual within the team is. And that comes from team orientation. If you are oriented only towards what you are accomplishing, what is your contribution, what you are gaining as a return from your contribution, if the orientation is all about you, then the chances are that you will not collaborate. So if you want to encourage collaboration, the focus on the team should always be on what we as a team want to accomplish, what we as a team want to be recognized for, right? So it's all about how you are oriented towards the group of people than you yourself. Now, the third element is on ownership. Again, ownership is something different to accountability. Many people kind of merge both or talk about that as synonyms. But accountability is doing what you are supposed to do. Means going by your job description. You are accountable to deliver whatever your job description defines or demands. But ownership comes with a sense of going beyond the job description. Again, that means if you run into issue as a team, you do everything that you can rather than just doing what is, defined by your job description. So that is why it is important to move the team from a sense of accountability to sense of ownership. So from a cultural point of view, it's important for us to focus on these three elements. Now, the next one, from a process, as a team, when you are looking at, you focus on first the business processes that you are contributing to. When we say business process, the set of business functions, which we might call business process or a value stream or a value chain, that gives a meaningful outcome for the organization or the product or the portfolio that you are contributing to. And your focus should be on what you are contributing from your point of view as a team as an outcome to that particular business process or value stream. That is one thing you need to focus on. The second, operations. And most of the time we just think about delivering something, but you also think about the maintenance part, how you are able to maintain the availability of that particular functionality that you are talking about, right? So that also is something you have to focus on. And delivery processes for the seamlessness or straight-through processing you want to bring into the system. How automated is the system that you are, working on? And also, how seamless, how many minimal, how minimal handoffs you have in the system, and how you are managing that handoff as well, right? So that the waiting time is very less. So that is something also you will focus on from a delivery process perspective. And the next one is about capabilities. What capabilities you as a team would focus on? First is building cross-functional capabilities within the team. That means whatever capability you need for you to deliver the outcome that you are intending to contribute to the value chain or value stream or business process that you are, part of. So those capabilities should be built within the team so that the dependencies that we are talking about externally are quite minimal. Right? That is the first one. Then our focus is more on executional capability. So how you can execute things that you are committing to, right? That are part of the backlog that we talk about from a product management point of view. And then how you can build leadership within the team. Agile is, or agility can be achieved only when there is a distributed leadership. That means we are talking about leadership at all levels, not just leadership by hierarchy or leadership by a job profile. No, leadership at all levels, so that the decisions can be made where the maximum information is available. And that comes with the team developing leadership capabilities. Everybody in the organization should be a leader, and that is what should be the focus on from a team agility point of view also. Otherwise, it's very difficult for us to achieve agility because you need to make decisions as a team, and you should be open to fail fast, as someone was saying, right? And learn and move. How you as a team can learn from the mistakes that you make and not repeat those mistakes. So that's about building capabilities. The next one is about leadership. Now, as a leader for any team, that could be a team lead, technical lead, or a manager, or whatever you want to call, the first thing you need to focus on is making the team autonomous. That means there should be a sense of delegation that you bring to the table. Now, as leaders, we delegate, but what we delegate? We delegate tasks. But if you have to make team autonomous, delegating tasks only will not help. What you need to delegate is delegate authority to make decisions, and that will build the capability as well. Then number two, empowerment. Within the boundaries that you have defined for the team, you should empower the team to make decisions, and that is when the leadership capabilities also build. Empowerment does not mean that you just take hands off and you leave them to fail, right? But empowerment comes with you being there to understand what decisions they are making and ensure they make the right decisions. That is where you as a leader will work on sustenance. If you build the right empowerment and right leadership within the team, then the team will sustain the agility in the long run. So as a leader at a team level, you need to focus on making the team autonomous, empowering the team to make decisions, and make the sustenance possible in the long term. And if you have a question, then what will I do as a leader is ability to provide that vision, clarity of vision that the team is looking for, build continuously the capabilities, leadership capabilities of the team, and be there as a coach, a guide, a mentor for them to elevate themselves, right? So that is what your role as a leader is when the team is moving to Agile. So these are the six as elements within the within the team level, and we looked at different aspects within each of them for us to focus on if you are looking at team level agility. Now, what KPIs would we look at when we are talking about team level agility? Now, team agility can be measured by three different aspects again. One, what is the level of agility within the team is coming measured on. No, I'm not saying all of these. You can pick and choose which one makes sense for your team as a whole that you are looking to build agility on. So value delivered in terms of software could be the working software that we call as, in terms of education, as I said, it could be the understanding of the topic the students carry and can connect back on when you are coming back to the class after 3 days or 4 days, right? So that is something is value delivered again for in terms of education. In terms of construction, if you talk about, are you able to complete one flat at a time, as a team before moving on to the next construction. So that could be one of the value delivered for the team from a construction standpoint, right? Value is what you are looking as a meaningful outcome in the area of work that you are delivering or in the area of outcome you are contributing to. Now, the next one is on-time delivery. If you deliver value, but again, if you are not doing it in time, then you start decreasing the value that you are delivering because it's. Are you not able to hear me?
It's very much audible, Navriti.
Okay, fine. Thank you. So, on-time delivery, if your value is not delivered on time that is expected, then the value starts diminishing of that particular outcome. So on-time delivery is also something important. And delivery predictability. Whenever you say that, okay, I can complete this task by this time, how predictable you are. That means the guarantee of you completing that task by the time that you are committing to is delivery predictability. And then cycle time. We talked about delivery processes. So from a requirement origination to a requirement fulfillment, what is the time taken and how you are able to optimize that time? And that is something you can measure as well. And then the net promoter score, what is the level of satisfaction of your customer? And when we say customer, whomever you are providing that value to, right? So that is your customer. So in terms of construction, it could be the end customer whom you are handing over that particular apartment or even within the group. So if you are an architect and you have another delivery team or a construction team, how quickly you are able to provide the designs that they are looking for, various architectural documents that they are looking for, right? So that could also be the outcome you are looking at. Then those delivery people become your customers. And then technical agility. You talk about defect density, code coverage, and escape defects. Of course, these are more in terms of oriented towards IT, but if you take out the code coverage, I think the rest too apply for even non-IT as well. Right? Then you're talking about team culture, the level of happiness in the team. Are you happy, sad, what it is? So that also gives an indication of the level of collaboration and the level of trust and respect that is built within the team. And then level of accountability and creativity. As a team, we need to be. See, innovation is the name of the game today, right? If you can't innovate, then you can't sustain in today's world. So, how creative the team is, and this also reflects on the leadership as well. So, if you are, as a leader, are able to provide the right environment for the team, then you will see that the creativity and innovation is flourishing. So, that also gives an indication of. Measuring creativity and innovation coming from a team gives an indication of how the leadership is for that team, right? So that, and also the culture within that team. Are they able to openly express the ideas amongst themselves? Are the other team members supportive of what ideas are being expressed? Or are they pulling the ideas, pulling the people down when they come with some ideas? Sometimes they may be good, sometimes they may be stupid ideas, but it's still an idea. Right, so how the culture is defines the level of innovation and level of creativity that is within the team, and that also drives the attrition. Means many times we leave organizations for the people that we work with or the leaders we work for. So that means level of attrition also is something which you can measure in terms of KPIs. So these are some things which we look at when you are talking about measuring agility at a team level so that you understand and it is visible to you that there is continuous improvement within the team, right? The continuous progress of the team, and there is nothing like perfection. So you can continue to focus on increasing that one bit till the time you reach the 99.9999 whatever Six Sigma levels we talk about. Right, so that is the focus on team agility. So these are the essentially KPIs that we can focus on. Now, moving to the organizational agility. Now, what we will do is think about essentially same six elements, and what you focus on when you are talking about organizational agility perspective, right? How you see and what aspects within those elements you need to focus on. And that is when you can create a path. Otherwise, you will not be able to create that, you know, a roadmap of how you can achieve organizational agility. So, from a product perspective, when you are talking about organizational agility or you want to achieve organizational agility, what is the first thing you focus on? Strategic alignment. That means, is this product still aligned to the organizational vision and organizational objectives that we want to achieve? If you talk about, let's say, a telecom community, right? If you still have, you have a product that supports only 3G today, how many people are using 3G? Still, yes, there are people probably in remote areas that are using, but when you look at the market volume, the amount of people or the demand for any products that are able to utilize 3G is quite less. So from an investment point of view, whether you will focus on investing too much money into money and effort into innovating products in 3G pipeline, no. So that is the kind of strategic alignment that you need to think about from a product perspective if you are talking about organizational agility. And that should be, again, continuously being done. It's all about reducing the feedback loop that you have. And how faster the feedback loop is will define how agile you are, right? How quickly you are able to make out. And we all talked about, I think majority of you said adaptability. Now, in order to adapt, you need to understand whether it fits what you are trying to accomplish as an organization. That is number one. And then, is the market in need of that? That means, strategically, is your vision as an organization aligned to what the market is demanding? That is something from a product perspective, it is very important to understand. Then the second focus on is on implementing the product portfolios. You move away from project portfolio driven organization to more product portfolio driven organization. It does not mean that I'm saying project management is not needed, but what you do in terms of that skill as a project manager or a program manager will change in an agile organization. So implementing product portfolios that are aligned to the organizational vision and objective, and again, the ability to dynamically realign your investment and your effort, amount of effort you spend on a certain product portfolio should be quite flexible, and the ability to adapt to that change that market is looking for or the market is coming up with, that is something which should be the focus when you talk about achieving agility at an organizational level. And then external and internal dependencies. Now, as an organization, when you want to be agile, how much of a vendor dependency you have, right? So that also defines how agile you can be. So again, the idea is not to say that you should insource everything that you do and try to put everything in your organization. No, that's not the case I'm advocating for. What I'm trying to say is identify your dependencies and have the right level of recontracting, we call as agile contracting, right? So recontracting done to move out from a milestone driven service provisioning to probably outcome driven. So that is something you need to focus on. So identifying the external and internal dependencies as an organization which is constraining you to be agile is something that you will need to focus on when you are talking about organizational agility. Next, from a practices perspective, scaling framework driven events. Again, do we need scaling framework? Yes and no. If you are able to drive the right mindset, then you probably don't need the frameworks at all. If you take an example, you know, the COVID situation itself, right? So when the COVID struck, every organization went remote. There were very few organizations which could not move to remote. Now, if the COVID had not struck, think about how many years it would have taken for big organizations like TCS or Wipro to be completely remote, or Google for that matter, right? Any organization. Because they were so traditional in approach, at least the Wipros and the, you know, TCS, more Indian organizations are more traditional in approach. So in that context, if you think about, do we need scaling framework for us to be agile? I would say no. But if you have the right mindset that is required for you to achieve that agility that you are trying to accomplish, then you don't need a scaling framework. But if to build that mindset, if you are not driven by some compelling emergency, but you still want to be an agile organization, then you need a scaling framework. And again, your scaling framework should be dependent on the type of work you do and the type of the type of hierarchy you have, the structure of the organization, what is the function of various divisions within the organization, what is the level of complexity that is being driven within the organization. All those things will define what scaling framework you choose, and that itself will be a separate talk if you talk about how to choose a scaling framework. Now, then the focus should also be on the emerging technologies that are coming out, and what this helps us to build the right products. You know, from a practices perspective, focus should always be on what is coming new in the market, whether it is with reference to any industry, right? So that is something, even if you are in education industry, what are the new technologies that the market is adapting to? If you still talk about, C language in a college today, C language is definitely required because we say that is the mother of all coding practices. So, but the whole world is moving towards Python. We are talking about augmented reality. You're talking about artificial intelligence, deep intelligence, natural language programming. So all those things we are talking about. If you still are restricting yourself as an education mechanism to teaching only the C language, or you're talking about Java still, then I think it will be very difficult for students to go ahead and, you know, become industry ready. So how you as an organization proactively look at the new technologies that are applicable to you as an organization is something which we need to focus on. And then all your practices should be customer centric. When I say customer, it's not just the end customer. It is also your employees are also your customers. You should treat them like customers, because if you have the employees with right engagement, with right levels of motivation, your end customer is more or less taken care of, because they are motivated enough to not think about themselves, rather than always think about customer. So customer centricity is also focused on the employees as well. Most of the times we as an organization, when we talk about customer centricity, we'll leave the employee focus completely out, and our focus is mostly on the end customer. But that should not be the case. Okay, now moving on to the next one. When you talk about culture, as I said, of course, culture of collaboration is something we all need to build. But what changes when you are talking about organizational culture? There is nothing like a single organizational culture which you can define. Organizational culture is a collection of different subcultures that are built within different teams or even different products portfolios, right? So that means when you talk about culture at an organization level, the amount of or the number of diversities that come into the cultural element is too huge. And that is why cultural transformation is something which we see that is something that takes a long time to build and deliver. So I always say that your culture should be your foundation for your transformation. Always start with culture. Rest of the things will automatically fall into place. And that's what we focus on. Organizational orientation. Now we said at a team level, you focus on team orientation, but when we are talking about organizational agility, don't just focus on your team, focus on what you are contributing to the organization and how we can be better as an organization. If every employee of your organization understands clearly how their efforts are contributing to the accomplishments of the organization, your organizational culture is more or less taken care of, which means the clarity of that vision and understanding is driven by the transparency that you have and the trust you are building. That transparency will build the trust within the employees of your organization, which makes them very well engaged, which motivates them to focus on end customer. That means just by transparently communicating the vision of the organization and providing that clarity at various levels of the hierarchy in the organization about how the each and every employee of the organization is contributing to the strategic objectives or the outcomes of the organization, that will automatically drive the right level of engagement for you to be agile. So organizational orientation is something which we should strive for as a right culture mechanism in the organization. Then you want to build continual learning and innovative culture in the organization. That means you don't keep resting on your laurels that you have accomplished. What else you need to learn? So learn, unlearn, relearn. So that is something which continuously needs to happen and built as a culture in the organization. So that should be our focus, creating a learning organization and creating an innovative organization. That is something from a cultural point of view, we should be focusing. The next one is from a processes standpoint. So if you talk about processes at a team level, we looked at business processes, we looked at operational processes, and we looked at delivery processes. But as an organization, when you talk about achieving organizational agility, how customers are engaged, what processes you have in place for engaging the customers effectively and be able to get the right feedback, again, bringing down the feedback loop or making the feedback loop completely optimal. That comes from having the right processes of customer engagement, right processes of employee engagement. And I emphasize a lot on employee engagement, the people in the organization, right? So that is something which is should be the point of focus. Then organizational policies around these two, around customer engagement, around employee engagement. How focused you are as an organization to make your organization employee friendly and customer friendly will define the level of agility that you can bring into the organization. Now, from a capabilities perspective, first is the technology and business domains that we are concentrating on. How you build your capabilities around these. The business, new businesses you want to venture into or new ways of doing the existing business you want to drive, and what technologies can help you drive those, right? The emerging technologies we are talking about, and building those capabilities is very much important. So, and you have to be proactive. You cannot always be playing the catching game. while it is we all say that the ability to adapt, that is more reactive, you know, when you say being agile is about ability to adapt, that is more reactive sense of management. True agility comes from proactive sense. That means you are able to foresee what is going to happen and then try to build capabilities on what the customer wants. Think about Google, think about Amazon. They are way ahead in terms of their thought process, and they are creating business opportunities than trying to grab the opportunities that are existing in the market. So they are creating new businesses, new business functions, new business needs. They are creating the needs itself. That means they are able to consistently look for those problem statements that they can solve from the technology capabilities they have built. And those problem statements are driving them to build new capabilities and new technologies as well. That's why we say everything new that comes, it is coming from either a Google or an Amazon. But why it is so? Of course, startups are also there, but startups focus on probably one problem statement to solve. But when you look at these big, you know, giant entities, they bring in solutions which can tackle probably 10 or 20 problems at a time, right? So that is something for us. If you really want to truly be agile as an organization, try to foresee the problems you as an organization can solve. That's the market creation than market fulfillment, right? That is something. Then the enablement capabilities. What are the supporting functions that make these, you know, technology and business domains effective? Whether it is the procurement, whether it is the HR, whether it is, you know, vendor management, all those. How you can build agility into those enablement functions which support the core technology and business domains that you have. And distributed leadership capability. And this is again one of the core elements for us to be agile. Decisions should be made where there is maximum information available. And that comes only when you are able to build distributed leadership. That means leadership at all levels, not just concentrating on talent development only at, you know, at a executive level or a middle management level. Leadership should be developed at all levels. That is when you can be agile. A decision can be made or will be made or need to be made by, you know, every individual in the organization at certain point in time. And if they are able to make the right decisions, and that comes from all the other elements that we talked about, their understanding of strategic alignment of the product and their clarity about strategic vision and where the product strategically fits into the organization, which objective they are contributing to. Those elements, if that clarity is there, then I am able to make better decisions that are aligned to that particular thought process. And that comes from having a culture of transparency, culture of trust, and culture of collaboration. All those elements contribute to it, right? So that is something which comes from, you know, distributed leadership. Now, as a leader, you should always be focusing on succession planning. That means that is something very important. It does not mean that, you know, we as leaders are going away, but your growth should be based on how detached you can be in your current role. That means, have you built the right level of capability in your team? Even if you are not there, they are probably functioning in the same level that they are functioning today, or even probably better than how they are functioning today. If you are able to accomplish that and become dispensable, right? Don't put that dependency on yourself. If you are being dispensable, that is when, you know, you have succeeded as a leader. And that's what being dispensable is, something which we need to focus on. Then leadership agility. Again, I will suggest a great book here. There is a book called Leadership Agility. Please go ahead and read that. It talks about five levels of leadership agility. It's a great book, and you should try and reach a position of co-creation. It talks about five levels. The third level is transformational leadership, and the fourth level is where you are talking about co-creating. Transformational leadership is the ability to carve out a vision for your team so that they start progressing on that path of that vision. And most of us talk about the level of transformational leadership today, but leadership agility comes when you go beyond that. One next is co-creation. That means next level, you are, rather than imposing your vision on the team, are you able to co-create that vision along with your team? That is the next level of agility. The last level of agility is where, when you are able to empower them and enable that level of capability in them so that they can define the vision for your organization. That means that you are coaching them, you are mentoring them, you are leader more as a coach. That is the final level where you are able to build that capability, help them realize that full potential they have. When you are able to do that, that is at the last level of leadership agility. You reach out, and that should be the focus. That means that is when you are able to accomplish leadership at all levels. So leadership agility book talks about how you can, what is needed if you have to transverse this path and how you can do that, right? So I would strongly recommend you to go ahead and read that book. Then if you are able to do that, build leadership at all levels, and you are able to successfully plan your succession, then sustenance of the organizational performance and organizational agility comes through as an outcome, even without actually you planning for that. So again, these are some elements which we talked about from a team perspective. And if you look at it from an organizational agility perspective, same elements, the aspects you focus on are entirely different. Now, what KPIs we measure at organization level? We are talking about increasing our market share as an organization, or market capitalization, or increasing our revenue. Again, improving our brand recognition could be a focus or KPI that we measure. The quality of our product offerings that we may want to improve. Bring down the level of attrition within the organization could also be an kind of a indicator to the right level of culture and built in the organization. Then the net promoter score, again, this is with reference to the organizational end customers that we are targeting. Increase in employee engagement, that also can be a right measure of your KPIs. And then time to market, how faster you are able to market what the market is looking for. These are some KPIs that you can measure at an organizational level when you are talking about organizational agility. Now, what changes when you are trying to move from accomplishing agility at team level to accomplishing agility at an organization level? The complexity of change is too high when you are talking about achieving agility at organizational level. Now, why I am saying this? This can be looked at from two point of views. One, if you are driving agile transformation top down, that means you are, I was part of ANZ Bank, wherein suddenly one day our CEO came out and said, we are going to become an agile organization. That means the complete organization was put through a level of disruption. You can imagine. Each and every employee of the organization, when we started with retail banking first. Everybody within the retail banking domain had to reapply for their roles. Means you either apply for the same role that you have, or you apply for some other role if you think you are a good fit. About 8 to 10,000 employees had to go through a redefinition of their roles and then go through the cultural assessment whether you are the right fit for that particular role and that also are the organization. And then again, the intent of that cultural assessment was not to say if you are not fit for, if you don't have the right mindset, you will be thrown out of the organization. But it was to understand what is your mindset, what is the kind of culture you are bringing from you as an individual to the organization, to give us an indication of what probably will need to be focused on from a change perspective, right? So that was the intent, whether you have the right mindset that is required for that role. If you want to apply for a coach role, do you have the coaching mindset? And if you don't have, if you do, you have, still have the traditional mindset, the organizational, the coaches or consultants used to guide and say, probably you are not right fit for a coach. You try and apply for some other role. But the level of disruption that and the complexity of change that was that got created was too huge, right? From that point of view. So if you are driving it from a top-down approach and suddenly you are saying that we as an organization want to be agile, the complexity of change would be pretty huge. The scale of disruption would be very high. And that does pose an increased level of risk in the organization. So there were a lot of people who were not comfortable to stay in that particular zone of uncertainty, which went on for probably 6 months to 1 year when they were defining the roles and there was lack of transparency in the communication, lack of clarity in what roles would be there, how many roles would be there. So that meant that a lot of people could not cope with that uncertainty and they started leaving the organization. And when people start leaving the organization, definitely the commitment that you have made to the customers in terms of providing services, products would also be impacted. So that does increase the level of risk. And also the scale of disruption also means you as an employee are probably not fully engaged in what you are doing. Rather, you are more engaged in the role that you can get or probably the amount of impact you are going to have from the new structure that is getting created, right? So, and that also raises the level of uncertainty. So if you are not able to manage the level of uncertainty through transparent communication, if there was enough communication to say, okay, this is how we are progressing, or even before the CEO came out and said, if there was some groundwork done to say that, okay, this is the level of impact we are looking at, some work starting on how to prepare the organization for change, probably the level of uncertainty would have been much lesser. And when that happens, if the organizational agility journey starts top down, the impact of failure could be huge because you are disrupting so many people, so many processes, so many products at one point of time. Failure could lead to a catastrophe for the organization. And then again, cultural diversity, as I said, when everybody in the organization, majority of the people had to go through a cultural assessment, that means as an organization, you are looking at 8,000 different types of personalities facing you or staring at you, then how you manage to cohesively bring them together and then form teams of teams that could collaborate, that is a big challenge. And cultural diversity also plays a very huge part in driving the constraints of achieving the right level of agility in the organization. Now, how to progress? What is the path that we take if we have to progress from achieving agility from a team level to an organization level? Now, you start with team. As a team, identify what you are contributing to. That means you need to start defining the value streams or the set of business processes which contribute a meaningful outcome to the organization that you are part of. That means the value streams could be three type of value streams. One are the business value streams that actually generate the business value or revenue for the organization. That is the core value stream that you have. Then operations value stream, which helps us maintain the business services and products that we are focusing on in the business value stream. Now, the last one are the enablement value streams. That means all those component teams which facilitate the business and operations teams to flourish so that we are, achieving the right outcomes that we are looking for as an organization. So when you start from team level agility, the next step is to achieve agility at a value stream level. Define the value streams that you want to concentrate on, and that should be defined by the strategic priorities of the organization. What are the critical value streams for you to focus on at this point of time? And that will be defined by why you are transforming as an organization. If you have that clarity of the why transformation, and again, if you want to know more about what all could be the whys, you can always look at my YouTube channel. There are a lot of videos on, these aspects that we are talking about. That's a complete set of agile transformation videos that I keep publishing. So you can look at those on how to define why we are transforming as an organization, what should be the core driving elements for you to go agile as an organization, and what should not be that, right? And though both are important, what should not drive you as an organization to be agile, and what should ideally drive you as an organization. So you focus on, first be clear on why you are transforming. And if you have that clarity of why, what are the most critical value streams that contribute to that why, and start identifying those portfolios and the products that contribute to that strategic why that you are defining, and then focus on the value streams which are critical. Start from there so that your transformation that you are driving starts showing its results right from the first value stream that you transform. Right? So that is where your focus should be. So business value streams, operational value streams, and enablement value streams that align to that particular aspect of your, critical why. Then move to the product. Once you start with one value stream, identify the critical product that you have focused on and what all value streams contribute to it, whether it continues to be strategically fit for your organizational objectives or organizational vision, and what return on investment you are expecting and what you are getting from that particular product portfolio that you are talking about, then the level of adaptability and flexibility that product has today and what you want it to be, right? That is something you can focus on. And that will be defined based on your the dynamic budgeting you can provide. That means if you are clear on what value streams contribute to what part of the product, what is their criticality, you can then manage the budget based on the strategic objectives and which value stream contributes to that objective. And how it changes, you can then change your allocation of effort, allocation of finances, allocation of importance to that particular value stream and that particular product. Okay? Then once you are able to manage agility at a product level, move to portfolio level. That means you are talking about a collection of products as a business portfolio, and then there you are looking at agility, and that comes with flexibility of a strategic alignment. This portfolio, how flexible my portfolio is, how strategically I am agile enough to prioritize different portfolios based on how the market is, you know, changing, and then how I can focus and probably build new portfolios, probably take out some portfolios which no longer matter strategically to my organizational direction and vision that I have built on. And then dynamic budgeting, of course, is something that we have to look at. Market need. Again, market need, we all think about, okay, look at what market needs and try to build our portfolios accordingly. But can you create the need is also something you have to think about. So be more an organization that can identify business problems that need to be solved, and then how you can build portfolios to be able to solve those business problems. That creates the market for you than trying to capitalize on the market that is existing. Then corporate functions at an organizational level, how you are, how well you can be aligned to the new regulatory needs, new legal requirements, new compliance needs, how the which are beyond the organization. For example, you know, Government of India came up with new tax slab structures, right? So are you agile enough to immediately bring in that right level of flexibility into your tax systems for people to then think about whether I want to choose the old system, I want to still be there only, I want to, or I want to build a move to the new tax system, and how you are able to make them understand what is the impact of moving to the new system versus staying in the old system. So those which are beyond our organizational control, and then how you can build agility in the system to be able to adapt to the external changes that are happening from a legal, compliance, regulatory perspective, and what policies will need to change because of that. So this is the path for you to progress from a team level agility if you want to achieve agility at an organization level. And mostly we see that this is how the people progress. Okay. I think more or less I have reached end of my presentation. I would be happy to take any questions that you might have around these. I'll stop sharing my screen. So I'm happy to take questions if anyone has, or any comments, any different views that you have is also welcome. I'm not saying this is the best and this is what should, is written in stone. No, nothing like that. This is my view. I'm happy to hear if you have a different experience or different point of view and share thoughts.
Thank you very much, sir, for providing a lot of deep insights. Of what interested me the most was on team culture and leadership agility, especially, you know, the fact that the leaders have to be detached and dispensable. And I have taken a note of the questions that has, you know, popped up at the time of the presentation. I will just take one by one.
Yeah, sure.
One question is from Bharat. He's asking, sprint duration to deliver MVP or valuable product needs to be adjusted from IT to other departments or from one industry to the other industries. So he wants to know your views on this.
No, absolutely. As I said, right? So if the moment you are putting a boundary to say this is how it has to be done, then you are not agile. So it has to be customized to the needs of the different industries that we have, right? So if you talk about, I take the example, I'm going back to the education again, because that's something I'm working right now on. So we are talking about semester being our MVP. One semester, how you are able to manage the delivery in agile. So that is the MVP we are looking at, and that is the duration we are looking at. So what applies to you, what best makes sense for a certain type of industry, is what we should focus on. Don't just go by Again, I may be beaten up for this when people hear, but if Scrum says, okay, it's only 2 to 4 weeks, that makes sense because they are talking about IT, essentially, infrastructure, IT software industry, right? That is the focus of Scrum. But if you want to take the principles of Scrum and apply entirely in a different industry, don't go by 2 to 4 weeks if it doesn't make sense to you, and if you can't provide a meaningful outcome in 2 to 4 months. If you talk about construction of a complex, I am saying, can you provide a meaning MVP in 4 weeks? It can't be, right? So then you have to think about what is the duration of my MVP and what my MVP is. If you have that clarity of what is the MVP for you that can give you some business value that you are looking for, and then everything should be structured around that MVP and the business value you define.
Correct, sir. Thank you very much for that answer. And I think this answer partly, takes care of our next question, which Palak has asked. And the question is how this concept of agility is applied to oil and gas projects. So can you add your views on this?
Absolutely. See, it could be applied to any of the industries. Now, oil and gas, if you talk about, what is the MVP that you can define for your team within the oil and gas industry, what you are contributing to? So if you can, of course, I don't have much visibility to oil and gas as an industry. So if you think about opening a new, if you're talking about Shell, for example, opening a new branch in a certain location, if that is the MVP you are talking about, then you look at what you want to start off as an agile MVP, right? Versus you are starting completely setting up everything as a Shell should look like. That means if you look at Shell petrol bunk, you go to any Shell petrol bunk, you have a certain structure, you have a what you call the additional coffee, tea shops, everything that is being set up. Then you have the petrol bunk, then you have the right way in, way out, everything set, right? But is that completely you need for you to start the petrol bunk? Probably no. If you have a tank that could store the right amount of petrol and diesel for you to start off, even you can start off only with a petrol distribution, that could be MVP if that is what you are looking at. So if your MVP should drive everything, whether it is oil and gas, whether it is construction or anything for that matter. So if your MVP is, I want to start earning revenue from leasing this particular place for myself as a petrol bunk, then you can start probably only with petrol and say, okay, we are starting off with petrol. I have constructed one tank and I am able to install one machine and start distributing petrol while the other things are happening by the side. The beautification is happening, the diesel tank is being constructed, all that is happening. So you can still be agile even in building petrol bunk as well, right? So it's about what you are looking as a meaningful business value for yourself and what is the minimum viable product that can provide the business value.
Correct, sir. And just in continuation to this, Riches has a direct question, and he's asking, which scaled agile frameworks do you suggest for non-IT organizations?
I would say that probably, you can look at one or two videos that I will publish in a week or two. You need to identify how to scale agile, first of all. That means what type of industry are you talking about and what sort of work happens within that industry, right? So you look at that and then define what all frameworks you will use within the context of your industry. Now let's take oil and gas for that matter. If you take oil and gas, then you will probably use Kanban also. You will have IT systems also driving the oil and gas industry. That means you will have Scrum also being used. Now, if you are using Scrum, you are using Kanban. That means then the kind of framework that can accommodate both would be safe. if you are a product industry that purely focuses on only Kanban, you can still go with SAFe. You can, there is no scaled Kanban, of course. I am still to hear that. Maybe you will find something coming up in future. But Kanban can be, SAFe can be used even where you have all the teams operating Kanban. So it depends on the kind of work that is being accomplished and what frameworks fit for the work that you are accomplishing. And then depending on the type of frameworks you have to integrate into the scaled model, you should try and choose the right kind of scaling framework. It's a long answer, but you know, it's contextual. That's what I mean to say. Contextual to that particular type of industry we are referring to and how and what is functioning within that particular industry.
Correct, sir. This question has, you know, in we have found out that in our recent sessions in pertaining to Agile, because this area, Gujarat and our members, there is a lot of concentration of non-IT people as well. So these questions come very often. And for the members, for the benefit of the members, I have just pasted Nivarthi sir's YouTube link. You can go and register that so that you can get on to new videos there. And one last question, sir. This question came fairly in the start of the session, and some of the points are already you have talked about the KPIs and all that. But I'll just post it for the benefit of the member. How is performance management system of organization going for organizational agility different from other organizations?
Yes, that's a great question. This is something definitely, you know, at least I have experimented on in the last few years, not at an organization level, at our team level, means where we have control on, right? That's where you start off, as I said. So what we did was, again, bring the transparency into the performance management. Now, performance management is always looked at as a big confidential thing. So what we did was we asked each and every member of the team on a monthly basis to come and present what they have done to the whole team, including myself. As a leader, what I have done for the team, what is my contribution in that particular month, we come and present. And everybody in the team starts rating that person, whoever presents, including the person itself. So what that gave is a transparent mechanism of measuring performance and then challenging people then and there. So if I said, okay, I'm putting myself at exceeded expectations and somebody has put me not met expectation, for example, then in that sense, I am able to go and challenge him because, okay, why you are saying I have not met expectations? Now then and there it gets clarified. So there is a sense of acceptability of levels of performance created throughout the year. So by the end of the year, when we reach the end of the year, already people know that, okay, this is what I have done and this is how people are looking at me throughout the year. So you then don't need to do the performance appraisal at the end of the year because it is consistently happening and people have a chance to, you know, upscale or correct their path based on how people are looking at them, right? So that is the kind of performance management we are doing, which means it's purely fully transparent and it's fully visible to the people as to how they are rated. And we are alone as a leader, I am not rating them. It's the complete group of people, right? So if you are saying I am the best, but nobody else considers you to be the best, then either there is a problem in you or how others are perceiving you. Right, and you need to give that opportunity for that person to correct either himself or herself or correct the perception of how others are looking at that person. So then it becomes very easy for me as a leader to, you know, manage the performance because everybody is managing the performance. Not I'm not putting my biases or my kind of influences on the appraisal itself, right? So can that be taken to an organization level? Yes, it can be taken. I don't see any constraint in people being able to do that. But you as a leader, do you have what it takes to openly go ahead and challenge your people and build that level of trust within the team you have, including you. You should not be an exception to that, definitely, right? So do you have that courage to take it up and do it for your team, would be my question.
I think that was an extremely insightful answer, sir. Thank you very much for presenting today at this event, which is PMI Gujarat chapter.